Welcome to the DIY Audio Guy YouTube channel. In this video, we're going to start a brand new adventure. We're going to replace the prefab subwoofer enclosure that's under the back seats of my old pickup truck.
It is really hard to get decent bass out of an underseat subwoofer enclosure, so this is going to take some outside of the box thinking. And I'm going to start by doing an experiment and building a test box using
passive radiators.
Let's start the adventure. Why am I bothering with an experimental test box in the first place? Here's why. This truck does not have a flat floor under the rear seat. It has these two cubby holes. The prefab box that I'm using right now is designed to fit into these cubby holes, and it's been working fine for 6 years now. But it's time for an upgrade. To make that happen, I need more airspace, which means
I'm going to build this enclosure out of fiberglass. Something I've never used before.
After doing some research online and a lot of measuring, I estimate that if I raise the seat up 1.5 inches and then take advantage of all that extra space, I can probably get 1.5 to 1.75 of a cubic foot underneath the rear seat. I want to make sure this passive radiator setup will give me the result that I want before I dive into fiberglassing an enclosure. So I'm building a test box.
And the adventure starts in WinISD.
So let's take a look at this in WinISD, and I want to show you why I'm going to be going with a passive radiator setup, or rather why I'm going to experiment with a passive radiator setup. So this is a transfer function for a Dayton Audio Ultimax 10. And these two passive radiators that I have. And what we see happening here is that this enclosure is going to peak. This is the resonant frequency of the enclosure at about 34 Hertz. And it's going to give you about 4.5 dB of boost at that point. And the F3 is going to be right here, which is at about 27 or so Hertz, about 27.5. Now, me personally, I like to tune my boxes a little bit lower than that because I come from more of a home theater background. My first enclosures and speakers that I actually built were home theater, and you want to tune those a lot lower. But you're in a car here, and you're going to pick up some cabin gain, so you can get away with a little bit of a higher tuning. Why go with a passive radiator? Why not do something different? Well, let's take a look at a ported. So the red line here is the ported, and we see that the ported enclosure is going to outperform the green passive radiator enclosure. So the passive radiator enclosure is inferior. Both of these enclosures are going to peak at about the same. The tuning frequency for the ported here is about 32 Hertz, and the F3 is even lower, so the ported performs better. Now we could tune this to give it an even better performance. We could tune it lower, we could tune it peakier. That's the beauty of both passive radiator and ported enclosures, that you can just keep tuning them until you get what you want. But here is the thing about the ported enclosure. The ported enclosure suffers from port noise, so we have to make sure we don't have any port noise. And if we go to the port air velocity, we see that we're right on the cusp of getting the kind of port noise we don't want. We're at 18.5 meters per second squared. And the lower that number, the less likelihood of port noise. So we want to try to avoid that port noise. And in order to do that, you need a very large port. And so we've got a 6-inch diameter port in this case. And that 6-inch diameter port is going to have to be 37.95, 38 inches long. So you've got a port that's more than 3 feet. We're talking about a subwoofer enclosure under the back seat of an extended cab pickup truck. It's going to be hard to find the airspace we need and also find space for a 6-inch diameter port that's over 3 feet long. And so a ported enclosure just doesn't work well in these underseat applications. So why not go with a sealed enclosure? So this is the transfer function for our sealed enclosure in blue versus our passive radiator in green. And we can see we get more low end extension. We get a higher peak. We get overall better performance with the passive radiator. Well, this is actually a plot for two sealed. And whether it is one sealed in a box or two sealed in a box that's twice as big, that transfer function is going to be exactly the same. What you want to do is you want to look at the SPL, and here's what you get. At anything above 42 Hertz, two sealed 10s on 1,000 watts is going to outperform a single passive 10 on 500 watts. But at everything below 42 Hertz, the passive radiator is going to outperform it in really all of the relevant range. And that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to get some low-end extension here and get some low-end bass. The other thing to remember, if I run two of these things sealed, I've got to throw 1,000 watts at it. If I run one of them, In the passive, I've only got to throw 500 watts at it. And this vehicle does not have an upgraded electrical system. There's no aftermarket alternator. There's no extra battery. I could probably get away with throwing 1,000 watts at the subwoofers. That is going to tax the stock alternator. And I don't want to do that. So I would rather see if I can make that passive work.
All that computer modeling is nice, but there's only one way to know how it's actually going to sound, and that's to get out into the garage and start making some sawdust. Let's build this test box.
So off the table saw we go, and we're going to start cutting some wood and make our box. Now, it's really easy to build a box like this. That's one of the beauties of a passive radiator enclosure. It's just like building a sealed box. You've just got a couple extra speaker hole cutouts in it. Now, this test box is just going to sit on the back seat firing straight up. It's going to be very long and very shallow. And it's got to be long like that so I have room to mount the subwoofer and the two passives side by side. Assembly starts by attaching the back of the enclosure to the bottom. I'm using wood glues and brad nails. This is the fastest and cheapest way to build a box. I really like using these silicone glue brushes to spread the glue around. And as far as the glue goes, any kind of wood glue will get the job done. Next, we're going to move on to the two side pieces. So we're going to attach the right side and the left side before we attach the front of the box.
The next part is very important. Make sure you pay attention.
I always cut test holes in scrap to make sure the drivers are going to fit. It takes extra time, but it ensures that I don't ruin my speaker baffle when I make my speaker cutouts. In this particular case, it's even more important since I've got three drivers that I need to fit into about a 3-foot length. And so I've got to make sure I have everything spaced out perfect so that it all fits. The passives fit just fine, but the extra time and effort that went into making this test piece paid off. The subwoofer did not fit into the cutout. I don't know why. I don't know if I wrote the specs down wrong. I don't know if the specs listed online were wrong, but it really doesn't matter because I can throw this scrap piece away and then make another test cut to make sure I've got the subwoofer cutout right. And when I make the actual cutouts in the baffle, everything's going to be just fine. I'm using a Jasper circle jig and my old Skill brand router. I've had this router for 5 or 6 years. It's the first router that I ever owned. My newer Bosch router is a whole lot nicer and it's a lot quieter. You know those people that say buy once, cry once? Don't listen to them. Buy what you can afford, and when you can afford better, upgrade. But keep the old one around because it's really nice to have too. This one stays attached to my circle jig permanently. So if I need to cut circles, I don't have to waste time taking my good router out of the router table and putting the quarter inch bit into that router because this one is always ready to go.
Let's lay down some glue and install the baffle.
And it fits perfectly. Now I had a few scraps left over and I just split those scraps in half and I made some braces. I probably should have used more bracing in this box, but there's not a lot of space to install braces, and some bracing is better than no bracing.
Even though it's just a test box, I'm probably going to have to live with it for a couple of months until the real box is finished.
So we're going to bust out the flush trim bit and then bust out the roundover bit and give it a nice roundover. When we're done, we bust out the hole saw and make a spot for the terminal.
The box is looking good, but we're not done yet. We could go ahead and load the drivers and give it a test bump. But remember what I said a couple of minutes ago. Even though it's just a test box, I'm probably going to have to live with it for a couple of months until the real box is finished. So in the next video, I'm going to carpet this box. Make sure you hit the subscribe button so you don't miss out. And in the meantime, here's another video that you're going to love. I'm the DIY Audio Guy, and I will see you on the next adventure.